forward. And so I hope you're enjoying your time here. We have two keynote speakers today. And to start off our morning session with the keynote is Frank Karlicek. And so Frank is the former vice president of KDE. He's also the founder of OwnCloud and NextCloud. And I think we're all interested in what he has to say today. So please welcome Frank.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Great that so many people are here and the first talk this morning. First talk is always tough, especially after the second day of a conference. So thanks for coming. Frank Karlicek is my name. I'm doing open source free software for a long, long time. It's getting close to 20 years now. So yes, I'm old. I know. Started with KDE, did a lot of KDE work. Started projects like the Open Desktop Org Network, the Open PC project. Also did integration with the OpenSUSE build service or the Open build service with Open Desktop for a while. But I think nowadays I'm mostly known for founding OwnCloud and also founding NextCloud. It's possible that some of you are here to hear a little bit of the background, what's going on here, but I have to disappoint you. So I'm not going to talk about any drama here, that because this is not fun. We want to avoid that. I want to talk about something a little bit more visionary and more as an outlook of where the internet is going, where free software is going, how clouds on the internet, what's going on here, and what we all can do here. So, but I have to warn you, I want to make this talk a little bit more interactive than usual. So I'm going to ask you questions. So be prepared. I hope you're awake. Okay. So the topic of this talk is fixing the internet with free software. Obviously a little bit provocative. I want to talk about first why it needs fixing. What's the problem with the internet? I mean, we all use the internet every day. And I think it's safe to say that we all wouldn't be here without the internet. I mean, without the internet, I can't imagine how something like Linux kernel or distributions like OpenSUSE could be developed without the internet. So obviously this is very important. So interesting about the internet is that it started decentralized. So at the very beginning, the internet was a project that was driven forward by universities and research institutions, all very decentralized. And I looked up the definition of the internet, and this is the first sentence of the Wikipedia entry. It says, the internet is a global system of interconnected computer networks. So you can already see that the internet is not one thing, it's a connection of different networks. So it's all very distributed. And of course, also the very first service providers and protocols and services and applications and so on, this is all basically very, very distributed. So what is distributed or decentralized? What does this actually mean? So I warned you, now I have the first question. Any opinions what distributed or decentralized means? More things can fail, yeah. True. Yeah, yeah. It's true.
Outside of the company.
Yeah. Yeah, true, yeah. More opinions? What is decentralized? Can you repeat it?
What?
Can you repeat what you said? Yes, exactly.
Outside of the company.
Yeah. So independent from a single company, I think, yeah. There are different entities involved, yeah. Other opinions, what is decentralized?
Loosely coupled.
Loosely coupled, yeah, exactly. That's a very good point. So I think what we can say as sort of summary is that there is no central instance. There is no central server of the internet. There is no central hub. There is no central cable. There is no central company. It's all very distributed and decentralized. For everything, there are multiple providers. Most of the stuff you can host yourself, or you can go to a service provider or host it in your university or wherever you want, but there are more than one service provider. It's not like, I don't know, AOL or T-Online at a time where it was clearly only one service run by one company. Another thing is, usually you can choose between different server software. So if you want to run something like email, there's more than one email server on this planet. So you can choose between different ones. And that's the same for clients. There are more than one client for email on this planet. That's also part of it. And of course, well, it's not strictly part of decentralized, but it definitely helps a lot. Most of it is free software. So there are free software, open source implementations for the operating systems, Linux obviously, the network stack, the server software, the client software, and all this together basically means that this is decentralized. So decentralized services. At the beginning, as I said, the internet was very decentralized. Does someone have examples of decentralized services on the internet?
Yeah. Amazon Web Service?
Yeah, the web, of course, exactly, yeah. Biggest service, probably. Other services that are decentralized?
Name services.
Name services, yes, of course. Email yeah. No, email, not Gmail, that's different. Not a lot of people know nowadays that this is different, yeah. Okay, so services, I think email was one of the very first services. Email is decentralized because I can run an email server at home. I can go to a service provider to get email. I can run email at my university or company or whatever. And I can choose between different server software. I can read it with different clients. And the important thing is we can all send each other email. Right, so I can send an email from my local email server at home at my Raspberry Pi to someone who has a Gmail address. And this person can send an email to a company. This all works together because there are open standards for that. And it's the same for Usenet or news, right? You have, if you remember, I don't know if it's dead or zombie state at the moment, I think. But the one of you who are a little bit older, as I am, know that at the time at your university, they were running news servers, and you can access these news servers and read news and post news, and they're all then distributed between different servers. So this is all also very decentralized and federated. IRC, of course, the same. There are different servers, there are different clients. I'm repeating myself, as you know. It's open standards, we can all talk to each other. The web was mentioned, obviously, very popular. There is not a central web server on this planet. Everybody can run a web server and link to each other, so it's distributed. XMPP is relatively new. It's also an example of a distributed messaging service. Okay, so that's all good, great, yay. Problem is, nowadays there's a trend to centralized services. You might wonder why this is a problem, I'll come back to this in a second, but I think this is a trend which is not so good. This has significant problems. So one example is file sync and share. So this is basically the idea that you can synchronize a file that's on your phone to your desktop and share it with someone else and then access it from your tablet, from your work computer and so on. And the popular services here are like Dropbox and Google Drive and Microsoft OneDrive. And this is a centralized service because it exists only once. The software is not free. And that's the server software and the client software. And it's, you have a complete login to this one vendor. So that's a problem. Other examples are social networking. Right, as you know, most popular Facebook, Twitter, Google Plus, and so on. Also exists only once, it's completely proprietary, you have a login, it's not an open service. Video voice, I mean, there are Google Hangouts, there's Skype and so on, so also very, very closed. Messaging services is actually interesting because, as I said, there is something like XMPP, which is actually distributed, but super popular. If you talk to the young people nowadays and look at their phones, you can see they're running like 10 different messengers and they're all, they're all centralized. Here's a picture. This is how it looks like. You have one thing in the middle. You can call this a service provider or software or the cloud if you want. And you have different users connecting to this central instance. Okay, so what's the problem, right? It's all nice. I mean, as said before, if a big company in the US runs a service, it's probably very stable and doesn't fail, right? It's very centralized. They have a big IT department. It's all very good. Okay. So what's the problem? First of all, this is an open source and free software conference here, right? And all those services are not open source and not free software. I think this on its own is already a big problem. The second problem is the cost. This might sound strange. You might think that what's the problem here? Dropbox is, I get a few gigabytes for free, and then it's all very cheap, and what's the problem? Well, if you really synchronize a lot of data, if you have gigabytes and terabytes, some companies and research institutions have a lot of data, if you want to synchronize that, then it suddenly becomes really really expensive. So cost is a problem. And of course, with these consumer services, you usually pay with your data. So if you use a Google service, which is often free, like Hangout, but you have to give up the data, your privacy and control over your data, and this is what you pay for. Speed is another thing. You might think, yeah, I don't have a problem synchronizing my LibreOffice files. What's the problem? Well, if you have a lot of data, if you synchronize your complete hard disk, everything you own, and synchronizing means copy everything first from your local hard disk to the US, and then back to your phone because you want to watch a movie, then this is a bit strange, and then speed is an issue. Legal issues, obviously, right? I mean, in the EU, especially in Germany, have very strict privacy and data protection laws. So copy everything around the globe first is interesting, not always a good thing. And then, of course, the question is backdoors and espionage. Right. No one knows what kind of backdoors these big service providers have in their code. No one knows because it's proprietary and this is all secret. But it's an interesting question, right? If these entities are basically of control of a big part of all the data on this planet, then the question is a valid one. Who has access to this data? Okay. So what can we do? What can we do here? And of course also, why should we care? And we are doing Linux here and doing this OpenSUSE distribution, that's all fun. Why should we care about the internet? Well, I think we should care because, as I said at the beginning, we all wouldn't be here without the internet. And the internet is a unique opportunity for everyone on this planet here for a really free and distributed communication infrastructure to exchange knowledge, to talk to each other. So this is all very critical. So I think we should care. So what can we do? So, different things. Fixing step one. Step one would be free software. So what do we do? Well, we are free software people, so easy. We start on a free software and open source project. I have a few listed here. Edge Explorer, nowadays called Pydio. Then OwnCloud, of course, Cozy Cloud, C-File. There are a couple of free software open source projects that basically implement, and I'm talking about files you can share here, implement these proprietary services as open source. Okay? So first problem fixed. Yay. Great. Everything is open source now. Well, if you look at this picture here, then you see, well, maybe this is my Raspberry Pi at home with a few people from my family, and then this is a company, and this is a service provider, and this is all good, and this is all open source and very, very fast, and you can look at the code and host it where you want, it's all good. But as you can see already, well, now we have a lot of islands. I mean, here, we only have one thing, and basically everybody on this planet connects to one central instance, which means sharing data here is very easy. But if you basically, if you have that, then, well, we have a lot of islands, and we are all very secure here, but also very isolated. So that's the problem, and this was basically the state of the file sync and share free software world like 2 years ago, roughly. So, first part fixed, but not really. Okay? So we need to do more. Fixing step two, this is what's called federation. So this is basically the idea that, maybe these islands here, maybe they can talk to each other. And this sounds strange at first look, but if you compare this with other services that I mentioned at the beginning, like email, for example, well, if this is my email server here, and this is like Gmail, and this is like OpenSUSE.org, we can all send each other emails, and this all works because we have an open protocol called SMTP. So this all works together here. So why is it not possible to have exactly the same for a file exchange? So that's basically the idea with federation. You can have lots and not like five, but maybe 5 million or 50 million servers on this planet, and they can all talk to each other. That's the idea. And this is, like I said, federation, and this is implemented by OwnCloud, also by Nextcloud, by Paidio. I have a few dots here. I hope that more projects join this initiative and implement this open API. There's an open standard, it's documented, and this already works today. Okay, so we can already basically connect all those servers together. Okay, so how does this work in reality? This is here a screenshot. I didn't want to use some well-known software here, so I created the OpenSUSE cloud here, as you can see. It's green, A. here are my documents. So if I want to share something, I can click on it, and then this share dialog here opens. And here's this input line. And this input line, I can type in a name, and this can be someone on the same server. Or, and that's the special thing about federation, I can type something, I don't know if you can read it, username at example here, right? So this basically means, and this is the syntax is very similar to other services. You have a username at and then a host name. Same way as email, right? We have a username and you have a host name. Or XMPP, Jabber, same. You have a username and a host name. This is usually how federation works. And it's exactly the same. If I type in here Frank at franksupercloud.com, then this server here sends a request to my server and say, hey, there is this user called whatever, Frank, also wants to share with his other Frank. Do you want to accept that? And you click yes. And then those two servers, they communicate, and you have this shared connection between them, as you see on this picture. So basically solved, right? Same as email, same as XMPP. So problem solved. I'm done with my presentation. Victory. Problem solved. Okay? Well, I'm not so sure actually, because I think we can learn something from the past, from other services. Let's look, for example, at Diaspora versus Facebook. Who knows Diaspora here? Yeah, most people, okay? So Diaspora was basically a project who wanted to do a competitor to Facebook. With the same functionality, they even had a few features more, very good. But the main thing with Diaspora was that it was federated. So you can host like a Diaspora server on your machine, and you can do some social networking with people on different machines. So very good idea. Basically the same as here, right? You type in something here, and this other person gets a notification, and can like our status messages, and look at our photos, and it's all great. Fun. Okay, victory again. Yeah. So that's all good. But as we all know, Diaspora hasn't won. Facebook has won. I'm sure Diaspora has a few users, but I'm sure this is like less than 1% of Facebook. So what went wrong? Does someone have an idea here? People are too lazy to move, yeah, true. So what could we do that people move?
I was moving.
Other ideas?
Yeah. Well, maybe for those who haven't heard my comment in the back, so I was saying that it's the inertia and people are simply, well, too lazy or maybe not even technically experienced enough to set up their own Diaspora server.
But I don't have to, right? I mean, you can get a Diaspora service provider somewhere, same as Facebook.
Sure, but everyone is on Facebook. There's nobody on Diaspora.
But now.
It's a catch-22.
Not 5 years ago. Yeah.
I mean, we've seen that with things like Twitter and GNU Social or people using messaging services, and there are lots of free alternatives, take Telegram or Signal, but it's really hard to gain a critical mass and people start moving because there is no real pressure. Most people are not aware of the concerns, or they simply don't care if they're being surveilled and observed.
Yeah, that's true. Not a lot of people care about privacy, not a lot of people care about centralization, yeah. Other ideas?
I'm really strange. I've never joined Facebook. I've never played with Diaspora. But as I understand it, it's about the other people who are on the service.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really the critical issue. We've got a tendency to want to speak to our friends.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's similar to the picture I showed earlier about the file sync and share. You can have your own server. It's very secure, but it's a bit lonely. Right? You're basically alone on your server and sharing with others is not so much fun. And if you look at social networking, it's all about sharing. If no people are there, then it's a bit lonely. So next example, XMP versus WhatsApp. Right? I mean, XMPP, like I said, open standard, lots of servers, lots of clients, open protocol, great. And WhatsApp is only an example here. Obviously, there are a million others. But obviously, if you look at schools and young people nowadays, they don't use XMPP, they use all these fun messengers. So probably very, very similar reasons. As mentioned before, you have to move. As mentioned before, you have to find your friends. If your friends are not there, then this is boring. Identica versus Twitter, same example. Identica open source, you can host it yourself, it's all federated, it's fun, great, but everybody's using Twitter. Again, same reasons in my opinion. You have to provide a reason why people should switch, so that you have to provide a good user experience, fun features, very modern, and you have to find your friends. Akiga versus Skype, and so on. And I think if you look at what we're building here with Cloud Federation versus Dropbox and Google, the danger is that we are making the same mistake again, that we think, well, this is great, like OwnCloud and NextCloud and Pydio, right? We can federate and you just have to type in this ID and it all works together, and technically this is all good and fun. But the danger is that people actually use other services. And we actually might lose here. We're building something that is technically great and a lot of thought went into that, but the danger is that actually maybe the big services, they win again. And what we are doing, we can be proud of ourselves, we created great open source and free software, but do we really fix the internet? Do we really make a difference? That's not completely clear. Okay, so why didn't this work? I already asked a few of you. I think I completely agree with the answers. You can summarize it with first, finding people, also called the critical mass. So that's a term in social networking, which basically means if you're alone, if you don't find your friends, then this is a problem. If one or two of your friends are not on this platform, that's okay, that's not a big disaster. But most of your people should be there. You should have the critical mass. And the second thing is integration and user experience. We really need the innovative features. It has to be fun. It has to be integrated with other services. Otherwise, people won't use it. And this might be stupid stuff, like if you look at chat, where you can see that all these messengers, they have these crazy emojis and animations, and you might think, oh, who cares? My XMPP can do everything. Well, but if it's not really fun, then this is a problem. Okay, so what can we do here? How can we fix that? There are a lot of things to do. First, let's talk about finding contacts and the critical mass. That's a fundamental problem of these distributed and federated services, because it's in the nature of itself, has to protect your privacy. No one should know that I have a profile on my diaspora server. It has to be very private. On the other hand, my friends should find me. That's a bit of a problem, right? And this is also, I think, at the end, I think this was the biggest problem of diaspora. Everybody was really, it was really about privacy, but you can't find anyone. And the solution for that is, or that's a proposal at least, is that we have something like a lookup server or a distributed hash table. This is basically like a public telephone book. So you can basically compare this with a phone. If you get a new phone, a new phone number, you can choose if you want to have an entry in the public phone book, basically. And you can say, no, I care about privacy, I don't want to have this entry, then people can't find you. But you can still give your telephone number to your friends and I can call you, but you have to do this like one by one. Or you can say, oh, I actually like it that people call me and communicate with me. I want to have this phone book entry. And then I want to decide, should I be found by only my name, or maybe my, I don't know, the city where I live in, my address, or maybe even more, maybe a picture of mine. And this it would be exactly the proposal here, that you can choose that if you want to be found by others, and with which data. And this can be done with a lookup server. Lookup server could be done similar to a GPG key server, for example, if you know that. Something where you publish your information, which is public anyway, like a public key. In this example, your name and your federation ID. You can publish that, and that doesn't protect your privacy at all. Doesn't have to, because that should be public. That's the purpose of it. Okay. Second thing is integration and user experience. I think we all should open ourselves a bit more with integrating other services. So if you're looking for someone to chat with, if you're looking for someone to do a free software version of a Skype call with, maybe we should try to look into other services like with Facebook or Twitter to find actually my friends and then do the connection. And of course, integration. I think integration with other services like chat and voice, video, social interaction, this all belongs together. So if you think that a service like Dropbox will be focused on only synchronizing files, I think this is wrong. At the end, you want to share a file with someone, and then you also want to communicate with this person. So integration, I think, is also super important. Okay, so I think the presentation so far, this was all super theoretical, and I only showed like one or two pictures, really boring. So now I want to show you a little bit more real-world examples, which I think this all makes it a little bit easier to understand what I try to say here. So what I'm going to show you is part reality, but part also the future. So the first thing we need to solve, the first thing that people should be able to do is first they need to, as mentioned before, you should be able to get your own server. I mean, if everybody registered on the same service provider, then there's nothing to win. So you want to have your own instance. And there are different examples, right? You can basically use something like that's a Raspberry Pi in a case or something like that. Or you can go to a service provider, like a big hosting center where I don't want to have hardware at my home. I don't care. I'm fine with going to a service provider, but it should be possible to have more than one. And if I don't like one, I want to be able to switch to a different one. Or I get this from my company. Or I have a Linux server somewhere, maybe OpenSUSE, just with a simple zipper command, install the software on it, nicely packaged and pre-configured, and boom, then I have my own server. So the first step that's needed, we have to make it super easy for everyone to get a server. And it doesn't mean like hosting on our own. Not everybody's a Linux admin. Could be, but doesn't have to. But it's important to have different options. Okay, then the next thing, I want to use this service, obviously. And I created an example. The example is I'm going on vacation, and I'm basically taking lots of photos. and I want to upload those photos to my cloud. And here I have two examples. This is an iOS mobile app. This is the OwnCloud desktop client. So, and of course, there are more options. You can also do this with the web interface. So we have to make it super easy to automatically upload our pictures and our data. I mean, with the iOS client, there's an automatic photo upload feature, which means every time you take a photo, it's automatically uploaded. Same as with iCloud or same as with Google Photo. So super easy. Desktop client is the same. You just have to take your photos, put it into one directory, it's automatically uploaded. Web interface works the same. Okay? So I'm just walking around somewhere at the sea, taking nice photos with my phone, and I don't have to do anything. They're automatically uploaded to one of my servers here. It doesn't matter. So super easy. Okay? Now my photos are uploaded. That's great. And I can go to my web interface, and then I see something like that. As you can see here, the awesome OpenSUSE cloud here again. And here I have a photo gallery of all my photos. That's great. I can look at them and that's fun. Okay. But again, it's a bit lonely. I'm only alone here. I want to show this to other people. So what can I do? I click on this icon here and then I can share this with other people. In the current version of the software, and this is the case for OwnCloud and NextCloud and PyDeo and everybody else, you click here and then you can type in an ID and a name and then this person gets a notification. As I said before, that's a bit boring and also about critical mass. How can I find people on other servers? And then we need something like that. I click on that and then you can see a list of people. Well, these are the people that I interacted with last time. I just click on them and then the share is done. Easy. But obviously you know that this planet has a few more people here than just three. So what we need here is also a contact, a search field here. And the idea is if I type in a name here, it obviously searches the own server and also searches through servers that I'm connected with, but also should search the global phone book. This lookup server that I mentioned before. So then I have basically see the results here and I see nice pictures. Oh yeah, this is like here, this is like Richard from OpenSUSE. Yeah, I recognize the picture and the description. Yeah, click, share. So this is how it should work. Obviously, sharing is not all. So maybe there's another menu where I can say, additionally, I also want to call this person or send an email or start a chat session. Share something, look up the details. Okay? And of course, this is all federated, right? Calling with WebRTC, for example, email, obviously federated, chat, XMPP, and so on. So I think this is how it should work. Then you might wonder, okay, how can I find Richard? Sorry for using the example. So this is a screenshot. This doesn't exist yet. This is basically prototype software here. But this is something, this is a personal page from OwnCloud or NextCloud, where you can upload your profile photo and type in your name and email address and everything. The new feature here is that here you have these small icons, right? You can see this is public, this is private. If you click on them, you get a drop down like that, where you can say, okay, my email address should be only private. I don't want to share my email address with anyone. Or you can say, my email address should be shared with my contacts. Or my email address should be shared in public. And if I share it with public, then people can actually find me. They can type in any sharing dialog of any server on this planet, my email address, and then boom, you can see, oh yeah, that's Frank, here's a picture. You can already call him or chat with him and also share with him. So that's basically the idea. Every time I select public here, the entry that I marked as public is pushed to the central lookup server and then people can find me. That's the idea. There's already work going on for this lookup server. The idea is to not have one, obviously. It should be done as GPG key servers a bit, where you have different ones with multi-master replication. So it's basically doesn't go down, as mentioned before, because federation is always down. In the future, the idea is to do it with distributed hash tables, I'm working with the W3C organization to work on a standard for that, so that more people implement that. And of course, we also want to integrate proprietary services. So if I don't find, my uncle here, then maybe I can say, well, Carlton, maybe then look at Facebook. Maybe my uncle is on Facebook. Maybe I can find my uncle there. Okay. So the next thing we want to do is integration. So this is another screenshot of the awesome OpenSUSE cloud, where you can see my vacation pictures here. If I click on a picture, you can see that you can do comments here. Okay, so you can basically say, okay, comment this picture, and you can also post a comment and basically do social networking. You can also do a favorite here, something like a like, and maybe in the future you can also tag people, very similar to social networks. But this is all, again, on my server, but federated between different servers. Okay, but again, there should be more. Maybe I can click on Jan here, and maybe then I get a menu, which is like, do a call, or send an email, or start a chat. Okay, because basically commenting here might be fun, but maybe I want to directly call this person, ask, hey, this photo, where is it? How did you do it? And can we go there together to take another photo or something? Okay, then I maybe click on chat, and then something like that opens, just a chat window, and then you can directly chat here and talk about this photo. And obviously, this should be all open protocols and free software as before. So for this chat app, which exists, by the way, already, this is all XMPP. Right? You don't have to do this on this page here, because there are other ways to also to chat. And this is another example. Maybe if I click on call, maybe then a WebRTC window opens where I directly can talk with someone and talk about this photo. But this is not only about the web. Like, this is a screenshot of an Android XMPP chat client. So obviously you can do exactly the same chat that happens here about my photo also here on your phone. Or if you want to call someone, you can do it in the browser WebRTC, but there should also be a mobile app where you can directly call people on the phone. So this is basically the overview how I think this all should work. Basically, we have open source file sync and share solutions like OwnCloud, for example, that I can host myself with Federation, which already exists. That's great. But I think we have to bring this to the next level in two areas. First of all, we have to solve the critical mass problem. We have to find people. Only if we find people, then people will use it. So we basically have to give up the privacy a little bit, like similar to a public phone book where I can say, okay, I want to be found, then it's fun. And another thing is, I think we have to integrate with other services, like here with video and voice and chat and so on. I only have one slide left, maybe a summary, and then I was hoping for a discussion anyways. So the summary is, I think to fix the internet from this centralized cloud services, we can do something here, but I think we have to do it in the right way. We have to implement this free software, servers and clients. It has to be super easy to host. Maybe it's a Docker image, maybe it's a package for OpenSUSE, maybe it's with a device that you can buy. Super easy to host. Powerful features and good user experience. Sometimes developers like us, we sometimes forget the user experience, but it's actually important. We have to solve the critical mass problem. We have to find other people. We have to integrate with other services. All the communication between the different nodes has to be open standards, and this all has to be federated and distributed. So, and this is now the end of my presentation, and now I'm hoping to have a discussion.
Okay. Thanks for the vision, but might be a heretical question, but aren't you just creating another central service with that phone directory? Who owns it? And how can you protect it from being misused? This is spammer's heaven, what you're creating in this current form.
Yeah.
And how do you validate that the person you're finding in the address book is really the person you're looking for, not somebody who set up a fake account?
Yeah. Yeah, excellent question. This is not so easy. I think there are two questions. First is how you prevent another central entity, and the second is validation of people. I think answering the second question first, validation is something with a web of trust, probably, where you can see, okay, this person is like confirmed by other people, and there's a higher karma or something, and this is not implemented yet. But something like a web of trust, which is also a bit similar to how GPG works, I think this could be an idea. But the first question about the central entity, I mean, that's a tough one. What we're building here at the moment is something that is not running on one machine, but on different, which is then replicated around. So it's a multi-master replication. The idea is that not one entity hosts, or one entity can host one server, but then you have, I don't know, maybe 10 trusted organizations, maybe OpenSUSE is one of it, maybe Red Hat is one of it, maybe, I don't know, someone else is one of it, and we're basically replicating the data around. Of course, I agree that the database itself is then still very, it's a centralized database, yeah. That's true. But, I mean, it's difficult to solve. It's possible that there are different databases, and then maybe a server queries different ones, same as GPG clients query different key servers instead of just one. But yeah, that's a problem. Yeah.
So, well, I think one of the interesting questions is spam, because we learn in different ways that spammers do funny things that you don't want to have. And the other point is the critical mass. I think the best way, even if you don't like it, is some integration with Facebook, Google, Dropbox, whatever. Because moving the people here in the room is easy, but moving our friends, have fun.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, that's what I said earlier. We have to integrate with other services where the users are. We have to win them over. Of course, then the real vision at the end is that we don't need these other services anymore at some point. So I think we should have an infrastructure that can really live without it. But at least for the beginning, I think it's important to build bridges. Yeah. Thanks.
Can you build any groups or anything else? That you can say, I don't want to have other people on my own cloud or anything like that we have got with security, that we don't get any spam or anything else?
Yeah, so these people that I'm talking about, they're not necessarily users of my own server. I mean, I myself can decide what accounts I create on my own entity. So no one is using any resources or storage or anything on my server if I don't want to. But this is more about interaction with people on different machines, like I have a shared directory. Group sharing, yeah, this is... you're a power user, I can see it, because that's missing. Group sharing is possible with local users at the moment. Group sharing is not yet possible with federated users. Yes, that's work to be done.
So, two thoughts spring to mind. Yeah. One I'm just going to chuck out there, which is probably going to be really hated by everybody in this room. And that is, I find it hard not to join Facebook, because there are bands that will give me free music so that they can get my surveillance details. There are companies that I can't even browse their product list, because they insist on having my identity surveillance details. How are you ever going to get critical mass of users if people aren't going to be able to buy your contact details and buy the details to follow your behavior online? That's one of the reasons why all of these companies like McDonald's are advertising Facebook over and over again. And I don't think you have the marketing budget to combat all of the companies who pay to advertise Facebook in response for the tracking details. So that's point one.
Okay.
Point two is identity provision, both for individuals and services, is a complicated thing. You can either go down the PGP area, or you can go down the X509 type models. PGP is very good for slow building communities where people have met each other many times.
But it's not very good for things like group authentication and, more importantly, deauthentication.
Yeah.
And how do you work in a web of trust system when you want to say, hey, this element of the web of trust, I no longer trust? It's okay for deauthenticating individuals, but not for deauthenticating groups.
Yeah.
And so I have interesting areas of who's actually going to discuss terms of services between identity providers or services. Mm. How are you going to manage all of that? There seems to be a lot of complications in Federation that we've seen before in other communities that have done Federation, and you haven't touched on any of those.
Yeah. Yeah, lots of questions. Let's start at the beginning. Yeah, as we all know, Facebook, Google, Twitter, and so on, they have interesting business models, as you mentioned. Maybe they're directly selling your data, or they're making it available to advertisers. But whatever, they're basically, the business model is your data. So I'm not sure we really need something like that here. If you look at the examples that I mentioned before, like Paidio and OwnCloud and Nextcloud and the others, we actually have different business models. I don't want to go into details here, but none of those entities is earning money by selling any data. And I think it's possible to have a business model like that. Then to your second point is advertisement. I sort of disagree. I myself haven't seen any single Facebook TV spot or radio spot or something. I think Facebook and Twitter, they're basically growing out on their own. I think we can grow this too without an advertising budget. Maybe I'm naive and we really need at some point TV spots, but I'm not sure. If it's a good service, maybe we can do without it. I totally agree that we need to have a business model, we need to pay the developers, but I really, really think this can be done without selling any user data. So that's not mandatory. To your second point about Federation and IDP, I'm well aware of the fact that a lot of way more clever people than I am thought for long, long time about that, and there are tough problems. And I'm not standing here because I'm saying that I can solve that. But we probably want to learn something from existing solutions. And I mean, you mentioned GPG. There's a lot of work and brain power went into that, and I hope that we can learn from that. I'm not standing here and saying that I can reinvent it and make it better. It's just basically bringing these concepts into these ideas. Does this answer the question?
But I have a follow-up question on the first part. So if you're integrating with all these cloud services like Facebook and et cetera, which exist with a business model to just sell your data, how are you going to avoid them abusing that integration to end up selling the data of your federated users?
Yeah, that's true. If you authenticate against Facebook, you already give away some of your data. There's no way around it. They don't know what they're doing. So this is a risk, right? I mean, obviously you wouldn't upload your own address book. I think you don't have to. This is a specific right, as far as I know, that you can block. But at that point, at least Facebook knows who you are. That's true. Yeah. That's a compromise. Why I think. Also, at the end, we need to have our own infrastructure. We shouldn't rely on those others to find our friends. It's only temporary.
So I'm playing the devil's advocate for Facebook now. Facebook is not selling your data. What they sell is advertisement. What they sell is targeting clusters of users or groups of users. The only situation where you actually give away something like your email address is when you allow a Facebook app to access your data. So, and that's basically opt-in. On the other hand, that means if you were to build this one big directory, it could also be something with a business model driven by advertising. I'm sorry for saying this, it would be one possible business model. Like in 10 years from now, I will probably regret it if somebody really implemented that. Yeah, but it could be, in theory, doing advertisement in a sane way that respects privacy. So, yeah. Okay, enough playing devil's advocate.
No, Dex, very, very important questions. And if you look at a public telephone book, I think at least the commercial ones actually has advertisement in the public telephone book. I'm not sure this can be completely translated to something like that, but I completely agree. Yes, of course. I mean, the only solution I have for that at the moment, that the server is open source, everybody can host it themselves, can be become part of this master replication network, and then offer a service without advertisement, and then hopefully shuts down this other entity which has a website full of advertisement. But that's, yeah, something to consider. I completely agree. And now I also agree with your statement about Facebook. I think this is a misconception. A lot of people think that Facebook might sell your names or something. A lot of people use Facebook under a fake name. Facebook doesn't sell your name. In fact, Facebook doesn't care at all about your name. The only thing Facebook cares about, that there is one person who has this interest and always drives in the morning from this location to that location and is friended with this other entity. So he's in the perfect target group for this specific advertisement. And then they serve you this advertisement. They don't care how you, what your name is. So yeah, that's true.
So maybe also kind of the devil's advocate here, but the success of services like Facebook or Twitter basically has shown that a centralized service has merits because, well, people find each other, they're all there. And, well, I guess you have to separate between the technical term, but Twitter is also distributed all across the globe. It's not just a single machine somewhere in California.
Yeah.
But I think the real concern is that there's always a commercial entity behind it that owns all this data, and that's the concern. And maybe an alternative would be to come up with a service that is centralized from a technical point of view, but also has technical measures that allows to prevent privacy breaches from happening because, well, let's say the data on the central service is always encrypted, so the one hosting the service can't even make use of the data that's stored on there. But it still has a benefit for the users because they are all interconnected to each other and can communicate.
I totally agree. And then there are ideas. I think it had on my slide that in the future, like a full distributed hash table could be something, which is then fully distributed. Another thing is, in my screenshot I showed earlier, I think I forgot to mention that, when I showed the email address of a person, this could be hashed, for example. Right? This could be stored in a hashed way, which means I can't like autocomplete all email addresses on this planet. This would be a bit strange, right? But it would work that if I type in your email address, and after I type in the last letter, it says found with a hash. So it but yeah, something to work out.
Somebody was mentioning that Facebook is interested in your name. They're only interested in your location.
What you eat in your advertising profile, I think.
It's not only advertising, because you also mentioned they're using location-based services. Means that if you have a mobile device, they're tracking where you are.
Mm-hmm.
The advertising model, since we began with location-based services in the telecommunications industry, is that, there'd be great apps. Person is walking through a shopping arcade and then the advertisement for that shop before their nose will pop up on their mobile phone. Fine. But you don't need a real name. If we transfer data to somebody else, we need to be very certain that is that somebody that we think it is.
Mm. Yeah, I completely agree. Actually, I want to encourage everyone here to look at the Facebook advertising page. This is super important. If you just go to Facebook and say, I want to book advertisement, I want to book a banner there, that's super important. You can do something like, I want to buy like 10,000 or 1,000 banner views from people who drive by this pizzeria, because I'm a pizzeria, drive by this pizzeria every evening between 5 and 6, because at 5 or 6 I don't have customers. I want to have customers for my buying pizza between 5 and 6. So I want to show this banner to every evening drive by my pizzeria at that time. So you can buy stuff like that on their website. And this is why this works so much better than TV advertisement. Yeah.
Okay, so one more question after Bernhard's.
Okay, so I wanted to mention that there are centralized services run by non-commercial entities like the Kernel.org and Debian Project and OpenStack Foundation and these things, and they generally work very well. And I don't think we are concerned about these, so it need not all be decentralized, but commercial interests need to be taken care of.
No, obviously, right? I mean, this was a bit provocative here, but basically it's, decentralized is always good, centralized is always bad. Obviously, there's a gray area in the middle. But overall, I think it's a good thing to not have vital services of the internet in the hands of single entities. So that's mainly the point. Okay?
Any more questions? Last one.
Are you the first one on stage that I hear saying that we should leave the idea of the open source community telling the rest of the world to screw up with their commercial ideas, but rather step out, contact them, and use them as a basis to get information we need to get our own stuff running?
I'm not sure I understood correctly.
You're the first one I hear on stage saying that we should step out and contact proprietary services like Facebook, Twitter, etc. to get data we need to get our own stuff rolling.
Yeah, I think we need to build bridges, right? I mean, for example, we are all using IRC more or less, I think, or most of us somehow, right? And I think we are all happy with the service and it has lots of benefits. But we also have to realize that most of the young people, they use, I don't know, WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger or whatever. And of course, we can be proud of our choice and say we have the better technology and it's more secure and everything. But if you really want to change the world, if you really want to make it better, this was my first slide here. I mean, if it's only about myself, what works for me, sure. I mean, I have everything I need. But if you really want to change the world and make it better, then we have to build bridges. Then we have somehow, I'm not proposing to do a pact with the devil, right? But I mean, we have to build bridges. We have to win over all the other people on this planet that they use our technology. Our technology that we are building here together, so with bridges.
All right, I want to thank you, Frank. And please give him a round of applause.
Thanks.